This is my buddy John, who I obviously take everywhere. I'm really excited to be here today. I'm a professor here in the Department of Biology, and as a scientist, I find it really frustrating when we can't communicate science achievements in a clear way to the popular culture. So today I wanted to take this really great venue to convey to you some of the really great and exciting advances that we've had as a result of the Human Genome Project and how we can apply them to maybe improve medicine significantly in our lifetime. So just as some background, you probably all know that no matter what kind of living creature you are, whether you're a panda or a white polar bear or a bacterium, whatever it is that you are, a human, all of your genetic information is stored in the same molecule, and that is the molecule of DNA, which coils up into these fascinating structures called chromosomes, and they're held together by these monomers or building blocks that we call bases that you're probably familiar with, the A's, the T's, C's, and G's of DNA. And so your cells and every living creature's cells has a means of interpreting this secret code, right? And the way that the cells do this is by reading every three bases, right? And every three bases essentially code for one of 20 amino acids. And amino acids are the building blocks of protein. And proteins are essentially the molecules that do everything in the cell. So those amino acids are put together in the correct order thanks to the genetic code. And then those amino acids fold into these spectacular three-dimensional shapes that allow them to do the job that they need to do in the cell. Okay? So understanding a genome is essentially looking at the order of those nucleotides and how they code for these important molecules in your cells. So the human genome has been sequenced. And what does that mean? It means that all 46 chromosomes of your genome, all 3 billion nucleotide bases have been sequenced. That means that we understand what their order is, and we're beginning to understand what the code is, right? We understand what some of the proteins do, we understand what some of the genes do, but we're by far still figuring that out. Okay, so it's kind of an exciting process. I wanted to highlight here that this study was initially published in 2001. It was a joint effort by hundreds of different scientists. And what really struck me about this effort, it was one of the most monumental things that scientists have come together to do, right? Figure out the genetic code of humans, right? And this made people a little bit nervous because people were afraid that we were going to take away some of the mystique of what it means to be human. But one of the things that I love about the human genome is that instead of answering every possible question that we had about what we are, it opened up years and years and decades of questions, right? And I tell my students that are planning to be scientists that this is fundamentally the best job security you can have, right? It's like years and years of questions. The other thing that I like to highlight about this effort is that it actually involved a whole array of different disciplines. It wasn't just biologists figuring this out. Even though it's at the core of biology, understanding how our genome operates and how we inherited it, right? It's also all about chemistry, and it's about physics, and it's engineers and chemical experts, as well as mathematicians and computer scientists, all kinds of disciplines coming together to make sense of what these 3 billion bases are telling us. Okay, so the order of the bases is essentially elucidated in these machines that I'm highlighting in this picture here. These are called gene sequencers or DNA sequencers. And progress in this field is what made the human genome sequence possible, right? We used to do sequencing in the lab, and it used to be one little gene at a time. And technology really caught up with us and by far passed us, right? And it made it really, really easy to sequence a large genome like our own code very easily and quickly. And what we've done with this is, you can see in this picture, it's really kind of stunning. There's, you know, hundreds of sequencers churning out data 24/7, okay? So what are we doing with all that information? That is information that we can now mine and use for the betterment of humanity, right? And so all of this information is actually stored in public databases that you can access if you're curious enough, right? Ask the internet, right? As we heard earlier, it's full of information. Okay. As humans, we all share a common evolutionary history. And therefore, our genomes are very, very similar. And any two people's genome is actually about 99.99% identical, right? But if you look around this room, we're not all little clones of each other, right? We're all unique, and we're all very diverse. And the reason for that is because every time your cells divide, they need to make a copy of the DNA. And sometimes when we make copies of the DNA, and the reason you need to make a copy is if a cell is going to divide, as you grow, you're making more cells, and you need to pass those instructions to the new cells, right? So you're copying the DNA, you've got all these enzymes in your cells that are making that possible. Ever so often, you get a mistake, right? And so one of the bases gets changed for a different base. And this is called a substitution, right? And sometimes substitutions are not a big deal. Depending on where they fall in the genome, it's like, there's a mistake there, but no big deal. Sometimes it's, wow, look what I just discovered I can do that I couldn't do before. So it's a beneficial change. And a lot of times, they're a really bad change, right? So these mutations that cause disease or cause problems in the cell are what a lot of scientists are essentially looking at because they help us understand health in a better way. So all of these differences in our genome, not much, right? Less than 1% that makes us all different, are interspersed throughout our genome. So if you look at, and in this figure I have 8 different pieces of sequence, you can see changes ever so often in the information for each individual person. And so that's essentially what makes us all unique, right? And like I said before, we're all different if you look around. But think about what that means with regards to medicine. Our approach with medicine has been essentially a one-size-fits-all, right? You have this disease, you're going to go to the doctor, they're going to give you this medicine that has worked historically, and good luck, right? But we're unique. And we understand now that our genetic background can actually have a lot to say about how well you're going to do with a particular therapy or a particular disease. And so this is an exciting time, right? Because we've got access to that information. Okay, so how can the human genome help us improve medicine? So one of the first things is obviously, detection, right? Early detection of disease. We're getting really good at characterizing which changes in that genome are likely to increase your risk of a certain disease, right? And certainly in the news, we've heard a lot about the so-called,
hey.
About the so-called breast cancer genes, BRCA1 and BRCA2. Angelina Jolie made the news because she made the very courageous decision after screening herself and finding that she did have defective versions of these two genes to undergo a double mastectomy and remove her ovaries because she knew that her risk of developing breast or ovarian cancer or both was higher than normal. And she also had the additional information that people in her family, very close to her, her mother and her aunt, had died from the disease. So she made that decision with information, right? And so this can actually help a patient go to the doctor, figure out if you're predisposed to something, and then take the appropriate action or make the appropriate decision that is good for your own individual background and status in life, et cetera, right? So the decision that Angelina took is maybe not necessarily the same one that a young 18-year-old girl would take, right? And being predisposed to a disease just because you have the mutations doesn't mean that you're for sure going to get the disease, right? But at least you have the information. You can do something with that, right? So again, in the context of a good physician that can help you navigate those decisions. The other way that we can use this information is to improve the therapies that we give people. So it turns out that if you have a pool of people that have the same kind of condition and you give them a drug, most of the time, the people are going to have the desired effect, right? But ever so often, you're going to see people that have moderate to no effect whatsoever. And then there's always some people that get those horrible side effects that you always hear in those ads, right? That take like 20 minutes to list. Yeah. those adverse effects, and sometimes those can be pretty serious, right? So whenever you go to the doctor, this already happens to you, unfortunately, right? So if you've ever gone to the doctor and you get any kind of medicine for blood pressure, for example, the doctor will guess what the best prescription will be. He'll give you a prescription or she'll give you a prescription, and then they'll say, we'll evaluate in a few months. Come back in a few months, we'll see how you're doing. And depending on how you're doing, if you're doing great, they'll keep it there. If you're not doing so great, they'll up the dosage a little. If you're doing terribly, they'll maybe change the drug, right? And so eventually you'll find the one that you're supposed to be taking, but that takes time, right? And it's also time that you've been taking the wrong thing. Maybe you're getting all of these deleterious effects due to what you're taking. Sometimes you don't have that time, right? And all of this, by the way, costs a lot of money, right? So, what did I do? Oh. So it's not only the effects on the person and on their health, but also on their pocket, right? It's a huge financial burden when you're paying for medicines that are not even doing anything for you, okay? This is just a really scary statistic. The National Cancer Institute estimates that in the next 5 years, the cost for cancer care alone will hit $150 billion, right? Just to give you perspective, in 2012, the US spent almost $9,000 in healthcare for people, individual person, $9,000 per person. So it's a huge financial stress, as well as you're not feeling well, and your medicine isn't making you better, right? So why do I highlight cancer in this case? Because we've got at least two examples of cancer drugs that are specifically designed for a certain genetic background and will have absolutely no effect if you don't have the right genetics, right? And so one of them is Herceptin. This is an anti-cancer drug that is used for breast cancer a lot and other cancers, but it is only effective in tumor cells that have these extra copies of these growth factor receptors, okay? So if you don't have that particular variant that has multiple copies of this protein, adding something that inhibits that protein isn't really gonna help you. But if you've got breast cancer, you kinda wanna know that you don't wanna take Herceptin, right? You kinda wanna know that maybe you should start with something different. Another one is pyrenothal. This is a drug that has been used for over 30 years to fight leukemia. It's pretty effective against leukemia if it's treated early, et cetera, et cetera. But doctors have known for a long time that there's a subset of the population that can actually die from taking this drug, okay? And so why is this? Well, this all has to do with a certain enzyme in your body that breaks the drug down, okay? So if you're taking a chemotherapy drug, you wanna break it down and get rid of it after it's done its job, because they're really poisonous stuff, right, when you're taking these things. And if you have the active enzyme, that's gonna get broken down and you're gonna be fine. So the doctor can give you a high dose of it, you're gonna break it down and it's gonna be fine. But if you have a mutant version of that enzyme, right, maybe you're not gonna break it down as quickly. So the doctor needs to know that so he can give you or she can give you a lower dose, right? But if you're also a person that has a mutation that has a completely dysfunctional enzyme, you absolutely don't wanna give that person that drug, because it's gonna build up in their system and become toxic and potentially lethal. That's when your cure kills you instead of the disease, right? And that's, we wanna avoid that at all costs. So, can we get to a place where instead of having this one size fits all approach, we're actually customizing the therapy, the interaction with the doctor, et cetera, and tailor your treatment to your specific disease, given your own personal genetic background? I really think that that's where we're headed. We're already beginning to see that. People are already taking the genetic tests that are necessary to determine what kind of therapy you should be on for certain disorders and for certain diseases. And it's a very exciting time. And I think, you know, if you remember, I told you the genome was sequenced in 2001, right? So it's taken a little bit of time to mine that data, and there's a lot of really great scientists working on figuring all of that out. But just because you have the list of genes that make up a human doesn't mean that you understand what the whole story is, right? We don't know how it all comes together. Eric Lander, who is one of the lead scientists of the Human Genome Project, said that it was analogous to having the parts of a plane, right? If you have the list of parts of a plane, that doesn't mean you know how the plane takes off or how it lands, right? You need a little bit more information to figure out how that all operates. And so I think that given a few more years, this is really going to change medicine to where you go into the doctor, you'll show them your genome, right? And they'll be able to pick and choose what kinds of things will work for you. One thing I wanted to highlight is this kind of progress would certainly not be possible if the technology wasn't available. And the sequencing of a human genome is still pretty pricey. So it costs about $5,000 to sequence your whole genome if you're interested. I would say wait a little bit. It's like, don't buy the iPhone when it first comes out, right? Wait a little bit. I have an iPhone 4. If you wait a little bit, the aim is to go all the way down to $1,000 and even less, right? And then that makes it a little bit more affordable for more people to be sequenced. And this is a consortium that has been sequencing people left and right, because the first original human genome was only 5 individuals, right? One from each human race, right? And now we're sequencing as many people as possible. They're at 1,092. Trying to really get a feel for what is the true meaning of diversity in the human population, and what can we use this information with. So I'll leave you with, if information is power, and if progress is power, in the fight against disease, we certainly have both. Stay tuned, because it's in your lifetime.